An abandoned stone city and a mysterious monument perched seemingly at the top of the world. A BYU team makes the daily trek up 800 steps on a mission to preserve a Jordanian treasure.
It's very touching to think that people actually carved that facade on the rock 2,000 years ago, and it's still there for us to see.
But could ancient Nabatean technologies used here on the Ad-Deir Plateau help to solve modern-day problems?
I'm just dumbfounded with what Nabatean architects and engineers were able to accomplish. They teach us something new every day.
More than 2,000 years ago, a mysterious civilization known as the Nabateans carved the beautiful sandstone city of Petra in the middle of the Jordanian desert.
This culture is very mysterious because their origins are debated.
They were hidden. They were hidden even in ancient times.
The Nabateans were incredible architects, incredible water engineers, but also incredible caravan traders. It's an amazing culture, an amazing civilization.
After being annexed by the Roman Empire in 106 AD, and then suffering a major earthquake, this once great city eventually declined. Today, this stone city is one of the new wonders of the world and a Jordanian archaeological treasure.
We are proud in our history. We are proud in our archaeological remains. We are proud in our civilization. This is important for us as a Jordanian.
Petra today is a World Heritage UNESCO site. It's one of the largest archaeological sites in the world.
The 100-square-mile Petra Archaeological Park boasts a number of large stone facades, the most famous Al-Khazna, or the Treasury. And on the other side of the park, the even larger Ad-Deir Monument, commonly called the Monastery.
The Ad-Deir Monument is built into the rock, like most monuments in Petra are.
They carved these from the top down. These are huge. So it's one of the more important monuments in Petra and beloved throughout the world.
Although this is an iconic structure, very little research has been done here for 30 years because of its location. To get to the Ad-Deir Plateau, people and equipment must be transported up hundreds of steps, passable only by donkeys and on foot.
Nobody likes to work here because it's too far, far away from the surface.
It's 800 steps straight up from the center of the ancient city.
Everything has to be loaded onto a donkey and brought up. It takes about half an hour, and most of the students, of course, walk.
Good morning, Bruce.
Good morning.
You try counting the stairs, but you always lose count with how hard you're breathing.
For these archaeology students, the 800-step commute concludes in dramatic fashion at the base of the largest stone facade in Petra.
To be learning how to be an archaeologist in front of such a beautiful monument is an absolute bonus.
You look up at the mountain every day and you're like, look where I am. It's okay. Like, this is awesome. Who gets to do this? It's an amazing thing to work here.
This large-scale project has two objectives. It's a classic archaeological study of the plateau's role in antiquity. It's also a conservation effort between BYU, the Petra Archaeological Park, and the Jordanian Department of Antiquities to help preserve the Ad-Deir facade from wind and water erosion.
The project is primarily a conservation project to preserve this building. It's under a lot of threat from water erosion, the seasonal flooding.
As part of a comprehensive study of this site, the BYU team is enlisting new technologies. High-resolution scans of the facade document its current condition and help guide the conservation effort. And for the first time, Ad-Deir was photographed from the air using a scientific-grade unmanned aerial vehicle.
This UAV has an onboard computer. It uses GPS technology. So it's flying a very specific flight path and collecting data in a very precise way. We were lucky to work with Pix4D. Their software allows us to create these 3D models. It just provides us a way to visualize that terrain in a way that you can't do from a flat topographic map. We were seeing things from that flight that we just couldn't see from the ground. What that did was allow us to see all of the different archaeological features in relationship to each other And you can see how things are interconnected. You have water channels and cisterns and buildings all interrelated with each other.
This area where we have all these tombs along here.
It just brings it all to life, and it helps us as scientists to see how everything is interconnected.
We've discovered there's a lot more up on the Ad-Deir Plateau than ever was thought.
The UAV images, combined with traditional surveying, reveal more than 300 archaeological features on the Ad-Deir Plateau. The team is currently working on three different excavation sites here. Clearly visible in these new images is this mysterious great circle, which may have been a ceremonial pool and also part of the water collection system.
Today, we're working on the inner ring of the great circle. We discovered that it's actually a gigantic 60-meter diameter pool. Its probable purpose was to control the water erosion. The Nabatean water control systems here are incredibly sophisticated, and we hope to learn more about how they manage water.
We're hoping that by clearing these systems and understanding their various components, that we can resurrect them, protecting the monument, but also everything else that's on this plateau.
The Great Circle and other structures on the plateau are all connected. If these Nabatean systems can function again, they can be used to help channel water away from the facade.
As you can see, the erosion is very severe up above the doorway lintel itself. Water is coming over the top during the rainy season. You can see how the stone looks like it's just melting and being eroded away.
There is no any drainage system. As you see, it's an open plaza. If we know how to deal with the flash flood and we can protect the facade, that will be great for us.
Some people think that if you're in a desert, there isn't any water.
The wind and the rain are unforgiving up here especially.
We had a massive 100-year deluge last year when we were out here that closed down the park.
And this is the flash flood.
But the time that they have flash flooding from excess rain, they'll have huge deluges of rain.
When it comes all at once, which is the big problem with erosion. I mean, if it was coming gradually, you can deal with that. But when it's flash floods, you need major control systems in order to harness that water.
Because of its unprotected location facing the storms from Wadi Araba, the Ad-Deir facade is deteriorating from wind, sandstorms, and water erosion.
We're standing in front of one of the major side channels that brought water erosion over the top of the facade. These are now blocked and they need to be cleaned out and restored so that the water doesn't pool here. Water coming over the front is creating this crystallization that you're seeing on the wall. This is salt crystallization. And this is pushing and sloughing off the patina or the outer rock of the facade along the columns. This is being further enhanced by the dust storms that swirl in this corner because there's no longer a protective Nabatean wall to keep that wind off the facade. This sand blasts and further opens up the patina on the columns and the facade itself. So the standing water combined with that is causing increasing damage on the Ad-Deir Monument. So here at the central doorway, you can see the massiveness of this monument by me just standing next to the doorway. The sediment from the wind that's deposited on the second story above is thus pushing water coming from on the top of the Ad-Deir in a pattern over the doorway on either side that's causing worse erosion on either side of this entrance.
Inside this 26-foot tall doorway is a single empty chamber.
We're now inside the chamber room of the Ad-Deir Monument. You can see how massive it is in these kinds of buildings for memorials to, if this was for a Nabatean king, there may have been a cult statue here of him. So we just have no evidence for what the decoration may have been. Now we have a little bit of salt crystallization on the ceiling over here, you can see it. So it's very plain, it's very simple, except for the beautiful banded sandstone, which the Nabateans ended up probably covering up with plaster. So we're missing a lot of the ornamentation that used to be here.
Over 2,000 years, this stone facade has endured earthquakes, flash floods, and wind erosion. It also has a water source of unknown origin that is damaging the patina.
In this case, the seep is coming out from behind the wall, and it chemically reacts with the minerals in the stone itself to create these natural salts.
All water sources here are damaging to the fragile sandstone facade. So one of the first steps in this conservation effort was to clean out the second-story monument alcoves that were filled with dirt and debris. Geologists from BYU and from Charles University in the Czech Republic rappelled down to complete the dangerous task.
As far as we know, it has not been cleared in maybe 2,000 years. As the debris piles up, it then shifts the water erosion over the front, so that we're getting a lot of damage that's being done on the lower facade.
The three active excavation sites here, the cistern, the Great Circle, and the Temenos slot, were all important parts of the original Nabatean systems that controlled water on the plateau. Before the main courtyard can be excavated, these areas need to be restored.
Because all of the erosion from this side of the plateau comes to this point, it has made this slot, Temenos entrance, one of the richest archaeological find sites for the project. So everything has been washed down here from all time periods of occupation on the plateau itself. They have over 90 coins at this point. They've also found bits of gold jewelry up here that have washed down.
We find a lot of coins and pottery and other small items at this site because it's the erosional wash area.
I'm starting up the staircase that was discovered last year. Underneath this 2,000 years of erosion, you can see it's a beautifully prepped limestone floor from the bedrock. The mystery is how deep this really goes and what's underneath the present erosion fill in the courtyard itself. One of the theories we're testing is that not only was the Ad-Deir Plateau a major cult site, but it may have been the site of a Nabatean summer palace. So what we're finding, particularly in this slot entrance, is opening up new questions and new perspectives about how the Ad-Deir Plateau may have been used in antiquity.
Even by modern standards, the Nabateans were expert water engineers. They used the natural landscape to divert every drop of water into storage tanks and away from structures.
Everywhere you look, on the rock faces, on the cliff faces, there are channels, there are mechanisms for controlling the water.
And all the channels that you see, they lead to a cistern or to a dam.
And you can see how deep these cisterns are. There's a series of six or seven of these. So part of our project is to restore these cisterns that will catch all the water that would otherwise go down and erode the Ad-Deir monument.
One of the goals of this archaeological project is to restore these structures and, remarkably, use these 2,000-year-old systems to channel and store water to benefit modern populations.
Not only is it interesting from an ancient perspective, but it's also important for the local people to have access to water resources, which are still as scarce today as they were then.
The Nabateans of 2,000 years ago created a water engineering system as a gift that can be maximized for Jordan today. These people were very in tune with their environment in ways that we need to recapture. They teach us something new every day.
From learning about ancient civilizations in the shadow of an archaeological treasure to interacting every day with modern-day Jordanians, for BYU students, the Ad-Deir Monument Project provides valuable experience and perspective.
This isn't a museum where things just go to sit. This is a living, breathing site.
It's a great intercultural experience for the students because it's total cultural immersion. We're living in the village. We have Bedouin crewmen with us all day long. We have our Jordanian colleagues that work with us. I just feel really fortunate that I'm allowed to work here among these people that are so great to us.
We need missions like this. We don't need a mission that's going to be isolated from the local people. The students, they are so lucky there, and at the same time, the department, we are lucky.
It's an incredible opportunity to be able to help preserve this monument for Jordan. And probably most importantly, it's a great opportunity to help the local community.
I feel something when I'm here. I love it here. And I want my children to see it. That's one of my greatest dreams, is bringing my family up those stairs much slower and having them go around the corner and see it and know that that's important to me and have it be important to them. But it can't be that way if it doesn't survive. We need to protect it.